plan presented with ankle fracture. The patient is a long distance runner. So people who run and exercise a lot, they have a slower than average heart rate. So this is not terribly abnormal, but you can see that the P takes a long time for that QRS to take place. That's called a primary degree AV block. And there's really no major significance to that for ER purposes. It's an incidental finding, not a big deal. The QRS is narrow, it's followed by a T wave, and then the next one. So patient long distance running after an ankle fracture. So sinus rhythm, primary degree AV block. And the important thing is, this is last beat. You know how different it is from this one? Let's do a mark right here. You can see the Q, R, S, and then here. But this one has an abnormal S repolarization. That's because that particular beat, and I'm going to erase that so you can see. You can see that that particular beat did not have a P wave. So it's a premature contraction, so it's not coming from the sinoatrial node, but it's a premature atrial? No. It's a premature ventricular? No. It's a premature junctional contraction. And you know that because of that different S wave there. All right. So let's move on to the next slide. This one here is a sinus rhythm. Also has a, it looks like a primary degree AV block, but the PR interval gets a little longer here. Then it gets dropped altogether. There's no QRS here. Short, longer, longer, drop. That is called the famous Wenckebach block or Mobitz type 1 AV block. And the characteristic finding is the prolongation of the PR interval until a P gets dropped. This one here, 79-year-old man with progressive weakness. You get see a P wave, kind of a long AV block, a wide QRS complex. This one falls very close to it, and this one doesn't have anything to do with that one, and this one's kind of long again. So, either this is a Wenckebach getting longer and longer, or maybe a complete AV block in which they have nothing to do with each other, or it's a secondary degree type 2 in which it's just a P wave that gets dropped. So this one in particular is complete AV dissociation. We know this because if we take our calipers, those little things that measure intervals, we can map out every P to each other, and we can map out every QRS to each other. But when you map them between the two, they don't match. So it's a complete AV dissociation between the two. This patient is going to need a pacemaker placement. This one right here should be pretty easy. 59-year-old woman being resuscitated during cardiac arrest shows up with this rhythm. You can see pacer spikes right here. So that's a pace rhythm. She had a pacemaker, and because she was resuscitated, it's back up. So nothing else. We can't really tell anything else from this rhythm because it's being paced at the ventricle, so it's a very wide complex. However, you could shut the pacer off by putting the magnet over the chest and looking to see the underlying electrical conduction. But be careful to do that because that might be the only thing keeping that particular patient alive. How about here? You have a sinus beat, premature contraction. Sinus beat kind of slow, and two premature contractions. Now, these two premature contractions are different from this one right here. They are different, so that means that multifocal premature ventricular contractions, sinus beat, again, a double sinus, and then a ventricular tachycardia at 180. And now this ventricular tachycardia is coming from the same spot, probably the same as this one, because they're all monomorphic. They have the same shape. Number 15, sinus rhythm. You can see it right here, beat, beat, beat. Now, but there's a problem here with the P waves. Not all of them are conducting. These two got dropped. These two got dropped. So are they getting elongated and then dropping? Let me see. That size? No, this is the same size as this one. So they're not getting elongated. So it's not a Wenckebach. So it's essentially a type 2 AV block in which, again, probably needs a pacer because it's just dropping the P's. Now, the QRS is not normal. It's too wide. So it's underlying sinus with a complete dissociation AV block. Not complete. That would be a third degree block. I apologize. A type 2 AV dissociation with the drop beats and with aberrant conduction of the QRS complex. So this one here kind of looks a little bit like the other one right here, where those are getting dropped, and those are getting dropped, but otherwise looks sinus. The only other thing different from this one is those deep ST segment depressions, which if you were to flip that around, they're actually ST elevations. So that means there's probably some subendocardial injury pattern. What's this here? Okay, 65-year-old man with COPD, chronic obstructive pulmonary disease, and acute dyspnea, acute shortness of breath. Again, irregular, kind of the QRS are not even the same voltage from each other. So whenever you see that, consider pericardial effusion or something like that. But this one is irregular, but we have P waves. Look at here, there's a P wave there. If you use a little imagination, maybe a P wave here, you know. And so this is a multifocal atrial tachycardia. The main difference between that and the AFib is that you actually have P waves, but the P waves look different, as much as three or four different type of P waves, some positive, some negative, some biphasic, or whatever. 75-year-old woman with decreased level of consciousness. And what do we have here? Well, a very long PR interval, kind of like a subendocardial ischemia pattern right here, primary degree AV block, that's about it. So you have an AV dissociation, because here you go. Here's the deal. This is a P wave, and that one didn't get conducted. This one got conducted here. P wave. So all those there are P waves, and not all of those are getting conducted. So P wave here, P wave there, P wave there, P wave here, P wave there, P wave. So actually, it looks like they're mapping out, but they're not matching each other. There's a P wave buried in there, in there. So this is an AV dissociation or third degree heart block. Again, this patient's gonna need a pacemaker. And this is it for the beginner introduction, just to get you warmed up with different EKGs. We're going to move to the intermediate EKGs and see how we do with those. All right, we got here, I didn't grab the history on that one, but this is sinus rhythm at 82 beats per minute, and it has between the RR, there's a prolongation of that QT interval, so that there is pretty long. That QT, so QT, it's too long for this area here. But we see something we haven't seen before, right there and right there. So if you have PQRST, what letter follows that? U. So that is the famous U wave. And U-waves in the presence of a prolonged QT interval is synonym of hypokalemia. Remember that one. A prolonged QT interval in the setting of U-waves is hypokalemia. There are many other things that can give you U-waves, but because of prolonged QT, we can define that that's why. Let's move on to this next one. This is sinus bradycardia, slow. It's got some extra beats right here with compensatory pulse, so that's a PAC. But this is what I want us to focus on right here. Look at this thing. Whoa, look at that T wave. It's a monster T wave. Or we can call it that. The hyperkalemic T waves. Now, hyperkalemia is not the only thing that give you hyperacute T waves. Actually, ACS and coronary syndromes and ischemia can do that too. But in this particular case, it's hyperkalemia. This patient had a potassium that was very, very sharp. And we know the difference because it's symmetric and it's sharp pointed. That's how we know it's hyperkalemia versus other causes. And this is a young person too. weakness and lightheadedness.